Hello and welcome, everyone. In this video, I'm going to show you a very complicated but very interesting tarot spread, which is based on the Tree of Life. So, in the beginning of the video, we're going to talk about what the Tree of Life is and what it represents and how it works. And then I'm going to do a tarot reading for all of us based on the Tree of Life, just to kind of show you how the tarot aspect of it works, and also just to give us a tarot reading to see where we are in our spiritual development and how we could possibly improve and get in touch with our divine self. The Tree of Life is a concept from Jewish mysticism, from the Kabbalah, and the basic idea is that the Tree of Life represents God's creation and the emanations, how it's revealed, the process of creation, basically. And I also like to think that it's a model of human consciousness, in a way. And when I do my tarot readings based on the Tree of Life, that's how I interpret it. We have 10 different elements here, which are called Sephiroth. And there's actually an 11th one, which is to be found here normally, but for some reason it's not included in this image. There are many people who don't think the 11th Sephiroth should be part of the tree, but in my opinion it's an important element, so I will be using it in my tarot reading. And the 11th Sephiroth is called Dot, and Dot represents the human knowledge and understanding that arises from getting familiar with the Tree of Life and understanding how it works and integrating this knowledge into our everyday normal human lives. Dot means wisdom, so I think it's an important part of the tree. But anyway, let's talk about the other 10 Sephirot. The very first one is called Keter, and it's up here at the very top of the tree, and it represents the, I would say, the divine force behind all creation. And it represents this hidden energy that is the basis of creation. You might call it God, or the universe, or anything you want. I think finding a name for it is really not the point. And kind of like with the Tao in the Tao Te Ching. It's not the name that really brings the thing closer to us. So it really doesn't have a name, actually. But I think intuitively we all know what it's about. And so this is where the emanation starts, the divine emanation. And it's important, I believe, to note here that the Tree of Life is not really a hierarchical system. And that's why I really like it, because it's more about the different connections and the cooperation of these all these different elements and how they are all equally important in creating life and creating this experience that we call existence. The second Sephirah is called Chokhmah, and this one is also called creativity, or it means creation, creativity. And the other one here, Bina, number three, is understanding. So in my mind, and this is my interpretation, this is how I understand the Tree of Life. So if you disagree with me, feel free to leave a comment or just correct me. But in my understanding, these are the two basic ways of processing this divine wisdom that is coming from Keter. And creativity operates on a very raw, very direct level. All kinds of creative projects, and whenever you are coming up with new ideas, we don't really know where it's coming from. There's not a definite place where we're getting our ideas from. But when we're in the process of creation, we are feeling connected to this timeless, endless, infinite source. And that's what Kether is, in my opinion. So, one way of processing our contact with Kether is Chokhmah, where you're actively participating and you're actively creating using this power and your way of experiencing and integrating this knowledge is by letting it work through you. The other side, Bina, understanding, is a different approach. It represents the processing of knowledge through observing. You could argue that since these two pillars here, left and right, The left one represents the feminine, and the right one represents the masculine. You could argue that this is the more passive and more receptive way of processing this information, which is, information might not be the right word because it's not data, it's nothing that can be verbalized or or could be expressed in numbers or anything like that. But people try, and Bina, I believe, represents these attempts when we're trying to get as close to expressing and understanding this knowledge as we can by observing it, by inferring knowledge from our observations. And Chokma is more active, more focused on the output, while Bina is about processing the input. Number four is called Hesed, and Hesed represents loving kindness and compassion and service, being of service to others, and basically represents this limitless love that is emanated through God and the flow of creativity. And so on the other side here, we have number five, Gevura, which is all about limitations. It could kind of be a contradiction or an opposition here between unconditional and conditional love. But the main concept here with Gevura is that sometimes life is limiting what you can do, and there's blockages that you need to confront and you need to deal with. And that's what Gevura represents, as opposed to Hesed, with all this expansion and space and open-armed kindness, where anything goes. Tifereth is number six. And Tifereth means beauty. This Sephirah balances and integrates these two, Hesed and Gevura. And in my opinion, it creates a harmony that is the center and the basis of all beauty. So if we want to interpret the Sephirah in the context of human consciousness, I would say the Sephirah can inform us or reveal to us about where our sense of beauty comes from, what we find beautiful, what our personal aesthetic is, and where we can most effectively create balance, or what we need to create this balance. Then we have number 7, Netzah, and number 8, Hod. Number 7 represents free will, in my opinion. Netzah is all about the willpower of the individual and what one can achieve if they put their mind and heart to it. On the other hand, Hod represents God's will. So all of those events and circumstances that we cannot control, and the balance between these two Sephirot is extremely important, because if there's a huge dissonance between these two, then you're going to suffer. But again, Tifereth is connecting these two as well. So this is an important central Sephirah that is going to help us harmonize these different forces, if they are very different. Number 9 is Yesod. And Yesod is our connection to God's creation. So everything above here is directly in God's realm, so to say. And Malkuth down here, number 10, represents the physical world, the basis, the ground energy of our existence. And if you want to ask question where we are as human beings, we're all over. We are the tree of life. But most of the time, in my opinion, human consciousness is focused in the realm of Malkut, and we're almost trapped here in a way. So Yesod is an important agent in keeping us connected and keeping us in communication with the Tree of Life. Yesod represents the subconscious mind, intuition, and sexuality. So it's an important gateway to access higher levels of knowledge or deeper understanding. I don't necessarily like to use levels, because life is not a computer game, and it's also not a linear thing. So our spiritual development is not a straight line from A to B. And I think the Tree of Life represents the interconnectedness and the complicated nature, the organic nature of human consciousness and the human experience in a very poetic and very interesting way.